The Morning Call and PBS 39 present the 15th District Congressional Debate between Charlie Dent and Rick Daugherty.
Welcome to The Morning Call, PBS 39, Lehigh Valley 2012 Congressional Debate. I am David Erdman, editor of The Morning Call, and on behalf of our newspaper and partners, Muhlenberg College and the Lehigh Valley Chamber of Commerce, I would like to thank the candidates for participating. They enter their campaign's home stretch facing an extreme high intensity surrounding the issues. The economy and jobs are number one. There is health care, but there is also voter ID, gay marriage, taxing millionaires, abortion and contraception, immigration, foreign policy, the Keystone Pipeline, and gun rights. Tonight, on some of these issues, you will hear from voters themselves as we field the questions from students, the business community, and questions submitted via social media. By being here or watching from your homes, you recognize the importance of educating yourself on the issues and understanding what the candidates' plans are for our community. Thank you. And now I turn things over to our debate moderator, Amy Burkett, PBS 39 television station manager. Amy?
Thanks so much, David. You know, we have an amazing studio audience joining us this evening, and we're very excited to have these concerned citizens with us in the audience. And they are a great crowd, and we will hear more from them later in the debate. Tonight's 15th District Congressional Debate encourages a lively discussion on issues vital to our region. Later, the candidates will get a chance to question each other. Our audience has already given a round of applause for the candidates, Republican Congressman Charlie Dent and his Democratic challenger, Rick Daugherty. We ask that they hold their applause until the end of the debate now. At this point, we'd like to observe a moment of silence for the late Senator Arlen Specter, who died Sunday at age 82 of complications from non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. He was first elected to the U.S. Senate in 1980 and held the seat longer than any other Pennsylvanian. Well, right now, let's start the debate by learning a little bit more about each of the candidates. PBS 39's Laura McHugh tells us more.
The economy, jobs. This is the greatest issue. We have a jobs deficit in this country.
At a recent candidate forum at Kirkland Village in Bethlehem, Congressman Charlie Dent cut right to the chase and addressed the topic on most voters' minds.
Washington is borrowing 40 cents on every dollar spent. And I think the time has come that we engage in a very serious tax reform and spending reform that will help put the country on a sustainable fiscal trajectory.
Congressman Dent currently represents the voters sitting in this room in the U.S. House of Representatives, and he's asking them to send him back to Congress for a fifth term.
I just always felt this is a great way to help people, to serve people, and I was always very much engaged with a lot of public policy issues, and I enjoyed them, I was interested in them, and I wanted to get involved.
Serving first in the Pennsylvania House of Representatives from 1991 to 1999, the Republican then spent 6 years in the state Senate before his election to Congress in 2004.
My job is to be available, to be accessible, to listen to the needs and concerns of the people of this community, and then try to reflect their values as best I can.
A lifelong Lehigh Valley resident, Charlie grew up in Allentown, raised by his parents Marjorie and Pete, a Bethlehem steelworker.
It's a community where people want to live. It's a place where people want to work. It's a place where people want to invest. It's a great place to raise a family. It always has been. It continues to be.
Charlie graduated from William Allen High School and still lives in Allentown with his wife Pam of 21 years. Their sons, 12-year-old Jack and 16-year-old William, live at home, and their 18-year-old daughter Catherine is a freshman at Penn State, Charlie's alma mater. That's where he earned a bachelor's degree in 1982. He later received his master's degree in public administration from Lehigh University in 1993. Before beginning his political career, Charlie worked as a development officer for Lehigh University and an industrial electronics salesman. Today, he splits his time between the Lehigh Valley and Capitol Hill, where he serves on the House Appropriations and Ethics Committees.
There are people out there who are working every day with real problems, and we have to try to fix them. And so that's really what my job is to listen to people, try to reflect their values. And clearly, when you do good constituent work and you hear what people are saying, oftentimes it helps you develop a legislative agenda.
A legislative agenda that's helped Charlie win support for his efforts on job creation, health care, and law enforcement.
I was given an invitation to his job fair at Lehigh Carbon Community College. And I went, and I'm a success story at that. I was able to get a job through that job fair.
Charlie has done some really good work for his constituents in health care and worked with the emergency physicians to improve emergency care, to protect patients' health, and also for trauma care here and in the Valley and nationally.
He's a strong, willed individual. He's very hardworking. He's a family man. All of those things are important to me.
Now let's meet Charlie's Democratic challenger. For the past 16 years, Rick Daugherty has spent his days at the Lehigh County Senior Center, where as executive director, he talks to, listens to, and develops programs for the area's retirees.
But this is very popular. I really appreciate you doing this.
Oh, no problem.
You feel like you're doing a worthwhile thing, and you're also serving people that, as you get to know them, are oftentimes extremely remarkable individuals who did incredible things in their lives and are very humble. All right, thanks again. All right, enjoy your class.
A lifelong Lehigh Valley resident, Rick grew up in West Bethlehem and attended Catasauqua schools. His parents owned a travel agency in East Allentown, and he learned the value of social programs firsthand as a teenager.
It was successful. It provided for us. But when my father passed away at 15, it was a very dramatic time for us. My mother needed to take over the business. She was obviously very concerned. And if it wasn't for Social Security survivor benefits, we wouldn't have got by.
After high school, Rick stayed in Bethlehem and went to Moravian College, where he earned a degree in social work.
What I liked is that you were there to be of assistance to help people and to improve the community.
Prior to becoming the Senior Center's director, Rick served as district administrator for Congressman Paul McGale, led operations for New Bethany Ministries, and served as a caseworker at Pinebrook Family Services. He now lives in Low Hill Township, where he and his wife April raised their three children, Sarah, Eric, and Shane.
I couldn't imagine moving out of the Lehigh Valley because it's where my friends are, it's where my family is, it's a beautiful place to live.
Even though Rick considers his position at the Senior Center the best job he'll ever have, he's running for Congress to champion senior citizens and oppose changes to programs like Medicare.
And the Ryan plan for Medicare, in my view, just by getting my calculator out, isn't going to work. And it'll wreck the program. And I'm very worried that then senior citizens are going to be fending for themselves in the for-profit private insurance market. I got into this race, first of all, because of the Ryan plan for Medicare.
At a recent campaign event, supporters listened as Rick spoke about his passion for senior issues.
And Rick has a good handle on the problems that the average American faces, because Rick is an average American.
He understands. He has done the footwork. He has done the background work on our families.
Rick also spoke about his other top priorities, realigning military spending and stopping, quote, unfair trade policies and free trade agreements.
We know that Rick is strongly supportive of our efforts to eliminate those free trade agreements which have killed our jobs.
Though Rick's never held public office, he's no stranger to politics, having served as chairman of the Lehigh County Democratic Party for the past 6 years. This is Laura McHugh reporting.
Thanks so much, Laura. I'm going to get things started with a question for both candidates. Each candidate will have 60 seconds to respond, and we'll spend quite a bit of time this evening talking about the economy tonight. So yesterday, Reuters reported the largest 100 public pension funds have about $1.2 trillion of unfunded liabilities. There are reports the Federal Employee Pension Fund having a bigger deficit than Social Security. Gentlemen, how would you suggest we fix this? And let's begin with Congressman Dent.
Well, on the issue of pension reform, you're right. I think it's an even larger problem at the state level. Clearly, you know, you're watching states like California and Illinois right now that are on the verge of insolvency, and I suspect they're going to be turning to Washington for a bailout of their systems. The truth is, everybody in this country knows that our nation's long-term liabilities exceed our capacity to pay for it. We are going to have to take some strong corrective action to deal with spending reforms, deal with mandatory savings programs, which would include many of the pension programs. We all know the day is coming. I'm prepared to deal with it. I believe early in the next year, you are going to see a major reform on both the mandatory spending programs and the tax reform, and we're going to have to put this country on a sustainable fiscal trajectory. If we don't, we're going to look a lot like Europe, and I think we all know what that means. That means austerity and a sovereign debt crisis, which will not be something any of us want to face.
Mr. Daugherty, what do you think is a way to fix the federal pension fund?
Well, my first concern would be for those people who will rely on those pension funds to be able to get by in their retirement. So it's a critical issue. We have to fix it. We have to look at spending, spending in terms of health care, spending in terms of the military, and then we also have to look at jobs. We have to look at federal revenue increasing, and that's bringing jobs back from overseas that have gone there because of unfair trade policies. We have to look at both sides of that issue to be able to handle any of the spending issues we have now, but especially the pension crisis that you mentioned.
Okay, well now, let's begin the traditional question and answer portion of our debate. Our panelists are Colby Itkowitz, the Morning Call's Washington correspondent, and Chris Borick, a professor of political science and polling at Muhlenberg College in Allentown. Each candidate also has 1 minute to respond to each question. Rebuttal time may be given at the discretion of the questioner, who also may ask a follow-up question. We'll follow ballot order to start. Colby, your first question is for Congressman Dent.
Okay. Hi, Congressman. At the end of this year, as you know, we're facing what is being called a fiscal cliff. It's a combination of massive tax hikes and spending cuts. So what would a Charlie Dent deficit reduction package look like? Specific programs that you would cut? And how much of it should be balanced out by revenue and what types of new revenue?
Well, the fiscal cliff, as you pointed out, will mean the expiration of the current tax rates and also the upcoming sequestration. We're going to have to find about $110 billion in cuts next year. As a member of the Appropriations Committee, I deal with about 36% of all federal spending. I understand the problem. Half of the spending that I deal with in the appropriations process is for defense. Half is non-defense. There's no question that we are going to have to deal with the federal health care programs in particular. They are the biggest long-term driver to our long-term debt. Everybody agrees. The president agrees. All the Republicans agree. The question is, what are we going to do about it? Where I might differ with my opponent is that, you know, we need to protect a program like Medicare. We need to make sure it's there for those people who are on it and those who are nearly on it to make sure it's going to be there for them as promised. At the same time, we have to make sure the program is solvent for the next generation. Doing nothing is a choice, and it means it will go broke. So the long-term project is going to be to put Medicare and Medicaid and other federal health care programs on that trajectory, because those programs by themselves, largely the health care programs, are going to virtually consume every dollar coming into the federal treasury within about 20 years. So we all know where the challenge is, and so we're going to have to fix it. You know, I've been criticized for voting for
Mr. Dent. I'm sorry, we're out of time on that one. We do have a time clock here, so I would recommend that we watch the time clock. I'm sorry, Mr. Daugherty, your response to Colby's question.
Well, two areas. First of all, in terms of reducing expenses, the Affordable Health Care Act, I think, very successfully will tackle the escalating costs of health care, both with Medicare and in general. The deficit reduction through the Affordable Health Care Act by the CBO is estimated over the next 10 years to be at $210,000. Second, we can no longer be building weapon systems designed to fight the Soviet Union. We're looking to build a new aircraft carrier. It'll be our 12th. China just got one. Russia has an old one that's diesel-powered. Yet for some reason, we're building our 12th one. We need to focus our national security spending on current threats, not against the Soviet Union. I believe we should eliminate the tax cap for Social Security, which would make that program solvent for generations. And I do support the Buffett rule in terms of a minimum tax for millionaires.
Okay, Chris, your first question is for Mr. Daugherty.
Okay. Good evening, Rick. We heard that you have clear problems with the Ryan proposals for Medicare reform, and that was stated in the promo. What policy reforms, if any, do you think are necessary to be made to keep Medicare solvent for future generations?
Well, I really like what the president has proposed through the Affordable Health Care Act, because what he's looking to do there, Chris, and this is very substantial, is to pull away from the exclusive fee-for-service part of Medicare and to include health outcomes as being a huge financial incentive for hospitals, so that if I go to the hospital because I got injured, the hospital gets paid for that currently. If I then get an infection in the hospital gets paid again. The president's looking to focus on health outcomes as more of a priority as opposed to strictly fee-for-service. 75% of health care dollars are spent against chronic diseases like diabetes and high blood pressure. It's a huge part of our health care spending. So when we're looking at dealing with preventative care, we'll be saving a lot of money and we'll be providing better patient services.
Congressman Dent, your response.
Question on Medicare?
Yeah.
Well, Medicare, look, 10,000 baby boomers are becoming eligible for Medicare every single day, 15 million over the next decade. We have an obligation to protect people on Medicare who are on it now or nearly on it. My 83-year-old widowed mother is here today. I want to make sure the program is there for her. Doing nothing is a choice. It's a bad choice. It means insolvency. It means when my mom is in her 90s, I'm going to have to explain to her why her Medicare benefits are going to be cut because her kid didn't do something about it. So the bottom line is, we can shore up that program. And there are some ideas out there to do it. The whole notion of premium support is an idea that came out of the Clinton administration, Alice Rivlin and the Brookings Institute, not a right-wing think tank. And basically, that's one idea. I'm prepared to deal with others. But I want to make sure that seniors can keep their Medicare as is or opt for something else. And I think that something else would be a federally approved program, similar to what Medicare Part D is, similar to what members of Congress are eligible for today and other federal civilian employees for our younger generation. So we have an obligation to shore up this program, and I believe we have the capacity to do it.
Colby, your second question goes to Congressman Dent.
Okay. Congressman, women's issues have been center stage this election cycle, and some have called your positions on abortion, some votes you've taken in Congress, contradictory. Would you call yourself pro-choice?
Well, here's my position on abortion. I oppose partial birth abortion. I support parental notification. I oppose federal funding consistent with the Hyde Amendment. I oppose gender selection abortions. Beyond those restrictions, I don't want to criminalize abortion, so I think it should be legal under most circumstances. But there are some, restrictions that I do endorse, and I have publicly stated so. My opponent, I think, has more of a contradictory position on this issue than I do, but I'll let him explain that.
So, are you pro-choice?
I said I'm pro-choice, and I support I support reasonable restrictions, and no federal funds.
Mr. Daugherty, your response.
I would be considered pro-life. I do believe that life begins at conception. And therefore, I do not support embryonic stem cell research. Currently, I believe adult stem cell research has been very successful, even more successful in terms of medical breakthroughs. But that would be my position.
Chris, we're back to you. Next question. It goes to Mr. Daugherty first.
Okay, Mr. Daugherty, are there any added restrictions to gun ownership requirements in the United States that you would like to see enacted on if you were elected to Congress or just in general?
I'd like to make sure that there are adequate background checks at gun shows. That's what I would focus my attention on.
It was quick. Could I
turn to that?
I support the Second Amendment. The Supreme Court recently has ruled that the Second Amendment is an individual right. I agree with the court on that issue. Gun rights are sacrosanct to most Americans. It's our Second Amendment right. I would say to you that to the extent that we may need to shore up background checks as it relates to mental health and criminal records, we have seen some shortcomings with respect to reporting of individuals with mental health challenges who then end up buying firearms. What often happens is an individual needs to be involuntarily committed or adjudicated before they can be restricted from purchasing. But we've had some difficulties with institutions reporting individuals who have had these episodes, and it can lead to individuals who are purchasing firearms who ought not to be. And we've seen, obviously, deranged individuals commit horrific acts in our country in recent months and years. So essentially, I think we need to maybe look further at the mental health checks and criminal background checks on some purchasers.
Very quick follow-up, Congressman Dent. On Mr. Daugherty's point, gun shows, would you have any added requirements or restrictions on the sale of firearms shows?
I'm not prepared at this time to add additional restrictions on programs or gun shows like we have right here, many of them right here in Pennsylvania, right here in Allentown.
Okay, our third question from Colby begins with Congressman Dent.
Great. Congressman, Republicans, including yourself, have been critical of the Obama administration for the unemployment rate, that it hasn't gone up significantly since he's been in office. So what role does Congress or the government have to create jobs? Is it the government's role?
The role of the federal government is to provide an environment where individuals can create jobs. I think the best way for the federal government to create jobs is to really excite and induce the creative juices of American entrepreneurs. I think we need to have a pro-growth tax code. Specifically, let's broaden the base, lower rates for individuals. We can do this in a deficit-neutral way. We can do it in a revenue-neutral way. That's one thing we can do. That's how we deal with it. Let's allow for greater American energy production. That will enhance our industrial manufacturing bases. significantly. In fact, we need to open markets. In fact, I just had the Canadian Consul General down here last week. He wants American exports into Canada to fuel the oil sands, to help with the oil sands. There's so much we can do there. Also, we're going to have to deal with the national debt. The national debt is very much affecting our job picture now. We have a jobs crisis and we have a debt crisis. The two are very much related. To the extent we deal with a long-term debt issue, that will help free up investment in the short term, give people certainty and confidence now to invest and create the jobs we need in the shorter term.
Mr. Daugherty, your response to Colby's question.
It is a federal issue. And since China was included in the WTO, our manufacturing jobs have been decimated. They've been 34% have been eliminated. They've gone overseas. NAFTA allowed Hershey Foods to send 1,000 jobs to Mexico. And just recently, T-Mobile sent 600 call center jobs overseas. The federal government is responsible for making sure that our workers, who are the best in the world, have a level playing field dealing with other nations. You can't have a company just go over the Rio Grande and be able to pay pennies a day to workers there, pollute at will, and then send products back to us and expect us to be able to compete with that. From the beginning of the nation, we've had tariffs in place to protect our manufacturing and to protect our businesses. Beginning with NAFTA, that has ended, and you'll see a direct line of job loss once these free trade agreements started to get in place.
Can I respond to that?
It's up to the questioner.
Yeah, I was going to ask a question about free trade, so you... That's appropriate.
Okay, well, then I guess sum up. I would just say this. With respect to what I just heard on trade, I was just at the dedication of the new Hershey chocolate plant. 70 million kisses a day are being produced. $300 million just dedicated. 70 million kisses a day, that's a lot of loving. And I'll tell you, they're making candy right here and confectionery here. The reason why we lose jobs in the confectionery businesses is because of ridiculous sugar policies that inflate the price of sugar. And that's why you lose confectionery jobs in America. We pay twice the market rate. It's absurd. That's something I've been fighting for in Congress to stop that. That's why we're losing jobs in this sector, which is important. T-Mobile, which Rick just mentioned. T-Mobile, we lost 600 jobs in this county because the Obama administration Justice Department basically didn't allow them to merge with AT&T. We have the documentation. They said they would bring the jobs back from overseas, 5,000, maintain the call centers here and seven others around the country. It's because of the actions of the Obama administration's Justice Department and FCC that we lost those T-Mobile jobs. This was not because of foreign competition. It was because of the Department of Justice and the FCC. I'll be happy to provide the documentation.
We're running out of time. We've got to move on. Chris, it's your third question, and it begins with Mr. Daugherty.
Okay, Mr. Daugherty, do you think the U.S. policy towards Iran that has been established by the Obama administration needs to be changed? And if so, what type of changes would you endorse?
Well, I agree with the sanctions and the tough sanctions that they've put in place against Iran. I also agree the fact that we've been working very closely with Israel. Israel is our number one ally in the Middle East. We will always stand with Israel, and it's clear that Iran cannot get a nuclear weapon. So at this point, in terms of going forward, diplomacy, continued sanctions, working closely with Israel, and if necessary, a military strike, but not boots on the ground, is what I would advocate.
Mr. Dent? Congressman.
On Iran, let's face it, the Iranians are intent on developing a nuclear weapons capability. It's also quite clear to me that while sanctions, I've been very strongly supportive of these sanctions. The administration has tried to water them down. Congress basically forced its will on this issue. And the sanctions have been effective. Have they been effective enough to dissuade the Iranian regime from developing a nuclear weapons program? I think the answer to that question is no. I am not prepared today to draw any red lines, but it's quite clear that this threat is real. Iran represents an existential threat to the state of Israel. They may act on their own, and I think we're going to have to get other partners engaged more actively, the Chinese and the Russians. I'll say the unfree world needs to participate because it's in no one's interest for the Iranians to develop this kind of capability.
Just another really quick follow-up. So there be anything specifically different than what the Obama administration has done to date that you would endorse as a policy towards Iran?
Well, I guess what I would say to that is that what the Obama administration has said is that the Iranians are not prepared to develop a weapon until the Ayatollahs actually make the decision to do so. The Israelis have said, well, no, their red line is when essentially the Iranians develop a weapons-grade capability. And so I'm not prepared to draw that red line. A military option has to be on the table. I don't think anybody wants to do this. But at the same time, I think the Obama administration has said the same thing, but I don't think anybody in Iran believes them.
As a point of clarification, for follow-up questions, we'll only have 30 seconds to respond for the follow-ups. So 1 minute for the original question. Follow-ups we'll do at 30 seconds. That brings us to Colby, our next question, and it begins with Congressman Dent.
Congressman Dent, fantastic. Congressman, I'm going to move on to Libya, staying in the foreign policy realm. Secretary Clinton took the blame for the security lapse there that resulted in the death of the U.S. ambassador to Libya. Was that appropriate, or should some of the blame be shared by the White House?
Well, the buck stops with the president, not with the Secretary of State. Clearly what happened here in Libya was that the attack on the consulate in Benghazi was a premeditated terrorist strike. Unfortunately for the administration, calling it a terrorist strike disrupted or interrupted their narrative that al-Qaeda is dead. The truth is al-Qaeda has evolved. We were all thrilled about the demise of Osama bin Laden, but that did not kill al-Qaeda. They have evolved. They have become operationally active on the Arabian Peninsula and the Islamic Maghreb in North Africa, as we just witnessed tragically. It's quite clear to me that the administration wanted to protect that narrative of that al-Qaeda has been decimated, rather than face the reality that we actually do have an operationally active al-Qaeda operating in much of North Africa and the Arabian Peninsula. And that's the simple truth, and I believe that's one of the reasons why we're not getting clear answers from the administration on Libya.
Response by Mr. Daugherty.
Well, al-Qaeda has been decimated. Their top two levels of leadership are gone, and yes, they're still a threat. And again, that's why I mentioned before that we need to reorient our military spending towards international terrorism, and it's something where we can't go alone on. We have to be there with our allies. They have to be with us in terms of global security. With Libya, what my concern is that there were issues that were brought to the attention of the State Department that they were concerned about not having sufficient security, and that needs to continue to be looked into if that was adequately addressed, if that information did actually get back to the administration.
Okay, gentlemen, the first phase of our debate is now wrapped up. We are now about to turn to our audience for questions. From Muhlenberg College, we begin, and we have a representative from the campus Young Republicans and the Young Democrats. Each will ask a question of both candidates. We'll start with Lindsay Quentin of the Young Republicans. She'll go first, and each candidate has 60 seconds to respond. Mr. Daugherty will get that first question. Go ahead, Lindsay.
Do you think the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act of 2009 was the best bang for the buck to help grow the American economy? If elected, Mr. Daugherty, would you vote for another stimulus package similar to the Act of 2009 if it was up for a vote in Congress? And if reelected, Congressman Dent, would you vote? What would you do instead?
I believe the act was very successful. And remember, a good portion of that, about 30% or so, were tax cuts to the middle class. If that had not happened, I believe we would have been in a depression. In addition to that, Democratic programs such as Social Security and subsidized housing and unemployment compensation also kept us out of a depression. But going forward, we need to stop unfair trade practices. That stimulus package helped bridge us over what would have been a depression. But to the other side, for us to come back to have the economy that we need, that we had a few decades ago, we're going to have to stop unfair trade practices, bring these jobs back, a number of which I just mentioned have left, to this country, and increase federal revenue, and that's going to be the ultimate solution.
Now it's Congressman Dent's turn.
Sure. I voted against the stimulus. One, because it borrowed too much. Two, it spent too much. And three, it delivered far too little in terms of jobs. It was an $830 billion program. We were told that it was going to be an infrastructure program. The truth is, $27 billion out of that $830 billion went for roads and bridges. That's not a lot of infrastructure for that kind of investment. I also believe the amount of borrowing required is going to crowd out private sector investment in the out years. Many at the time said that that level of public borrowing was going to make it more difficult to grow the economy in the out years. Sadly and tragically, that has been the case. We've had 43 consecutive months of unemployment at 8% or above. We were told when the stimulus was enacted that the unemployment rate wouldn't rise above 8%, and at this time it would be below 6%. Again, that is not the case. We have people dropping out of the workforce at a huge rate. So we have the lowest workforce participation rate since about 30 years, and that's unacceptable. People who are finding jobs are finding them in the part-time realm, in the part-time sector. We need to grow this economy. This massive level of public sector investment is not helping us grow.
Next up, Jeremy Rushel of the Young Democrats from Muhlenberg has his chance. Again, each candidate has 60 seconds, and Congressman Dent gets the question first this time.
As students of Muhlenberg College, many of our fellow classmates are impacted by the voter ID law in our state. The Voter Empowerment Act, proposed by Senator Kirsten Gillibrand and Representative John Lewis, states that it will ensure equal access to the ballot box for all Americans, including students that attend college out of state and minority communities. If and when the House of Representatives votes on the bill, how would you vote on it and why?
Well, the question is about voter ID. Most of the action on this has been at the state level. I do support voter ID, and I want to explain why. I believe in counting every vote. I also believe in the integrity of every vote. I have had people tell me there's no voter fraud. Well, I remember in 1993 in Philadelphia, we had a state Senate race where a federal judge, Clarence Newcomer, unseated the sitting state senator, Bill Simpson, and replaced him because of massive widespread absentee ballot fraud. In the Minnesota race, we saw over 1,000 convicted felons vote who are legally prohibited from voting in that state. I can show you Berks and Dauphin counties where we had Acorn involved with voter registration manipulation efforts that ended up with convictions for some of the people involved. I've seen in the city of Philadelphia in the year 2000, we saw better than 100% voting turnout in some of the precincts. And there's a whole host of reasons why. We show IDs for all sorts of purposes, to board an airplane, to buy a beer, to do all sorts of things. We must present ID. I think it's a reasonable requirement to protect the integrity of every vote.
Mr. Daugherty, voter ID.
I think we have a good system in place now. If there was voter fraud, it should have been prosecuted, and it should have been prosecuted vigorously. There are no cases that have been prosecuted in recent history in Pennsylvania. I want to encourage as many people as possible to vote. As many of you know, our voting numbers now are very low. And I think this is going in the opposite direction, and especially for senior citizens. I know many senior citizens who are no longer driving, and their driver's license ID expired. That would not have been acceptable for them to be able to vote. These are some people that have voted for 50 years. Some are even in the Hall of Fame for voting, and they would have been excluded. So I thought it was wrong.
Okay, right now we're going to stay with our audience for a question from Tony Iannelli. He is the President and Chief Executive Officer of the Greater Lehigh Valley Chamber of Commerce. Again, each candidate will have 60 seconds to answer, and Congressman Dent is up first.
Okay, thank you. This question is actually for both candidates. And the question is, in talking to our 5,000 members and businesses in this Commonwealth and, frankly, in this nation, it seems that business is anxious and ready to jump into a greater degree into this economy, but they're concerned that perhaps maybe government, for lack of a better term, broad-based term, is not an all-in partner. So the question I would have for both of you, and that is that how would you and what legislation would you propose, what action would you propose that would allow business to confidently jump in with both feet into the future of this economy?
Congressman Dent, you were first.
Well, Tony, your question is a good one. I think the issue that Tony has raised here is the issue of certainty. There is a lack of certainty out in the community. People don't know what their tax rates are going to be at the end of the year. They don't know what the regulatory environment is going to be like. There's all this regulatory uncertainty as well. What we need to do is, for once and for all, establish permanent tax rates, provide greater regulatory certainty, rein in these bureaucratic entities, whether it's at the EPA or the National Labor Relations Board or the FDA that takes forever and a day to approve a new therapy or a new device or drug. We need to provide greater regulatory certainty. If there is greater certainty, there will be greater confidence. When there is greater confidence, people will invest. Trillions of dollars are sitting on the sideline in small, mid-sized, and large businesses because they're afraid. They have seen an administration that has been very hostile to their interests, very hostile to job creation. There are all sorts of rules coming out of the health care law alone. People don't know what their costs are going to be, and that's why people are holding back. That's why we're going to have to take strong action on this health care law.
Mr. Daugherty.
I disagree, Tony. What I would look at is customers. My parents had a travel agency in East Allentown. It was a small business, and they mortgaged their home. They put up their life savings, as many small business people do. They took an enormous risk, and there was no safety net for them. And when they opened up their business, they weren't worried about government regulations. They weren't even worried about taxes. When they put the sign up that said Daugherty Travel Agency, the only thing they were worried about was customers. And at that time, we had a strong labor movement, and their customers often came from Western Electric, Mack Trucks, where you had worked, and Bethlehem Steel. So when jobs come back to the community, especially manufacturing jobs, and people have good, stable employment, everybody benefits. Small businesses benefit, the entire community benefits. So my focus is to have customers, and to have customers, people need to have good-paying jobs.
Okay, gentlemen, now it gets really fun. It's time for our candidates to question each other. And we'd like the questions here, not speeches. Each candidate is allowed 5 questions if we have time. And again, responses are limited to 1 minute. So let's start with Mr. Daugherty.
Charlie, since you would like to repeal the Affordable Health Care Act, what is your health care plan for all Americans, including how would it be financed?
Good. Rick, I think you said during this program that the Affordable Care Act would lower the deficit. If you believe that, you will believe anything. The truth is the Affordable Care Act is going to destroy, according to the Congressional Budget Office, 800,000 jobs over the next 10 years. What I would recommend that we do is deal with the cost drivers of health care. Specifically, let's deal with comprehensive medical liability reform. That is a cost driver. That's one thing we should do. Let's give small businesses the same ability to purchase insurance, just as large businesses do. Let them pool together. Large businesses self-insure. Let's give small businesses the ability to pull together, get those same kinds of discounts that that a larger business would receive. Allow people to purchase insurance cross-state. Take care of pre-existing condition exclusions, people with these pre-existing conditions. Allow them to participate in existing state-run high-risk pools, but make them work. You can use a reinsurance model to do that as well. But that's something we should do, as well as allowing for greater portability so people can move from job to job. Those are things that we can all be part of my plan, short of taking over the whole healthcare system.
Can I have a rebuttal?
Well, you can. It's going to cost you a question later.
I can?
Your choice. Go ahead.
Okay. The CBO report that you mentioned about the 800,000 jobs was March 30th, 2011. And this is what it says. It says, the CBO estimates that the legislation on net will reduce the amount of labor used in the economy by a small amount, roughly 0.5%, primarily by reducing the amount of labor that workers choose to supply. What that means isn't that jobs are going to be leaving, it's that workers, and these are middle-class workers who have assets, who have to stay employed for health care so they don't lose their savings. They will now have the freedom to decide whether they want to continue to work or not.
That's a very long question, Mr. Daugherty.
Well, the answer to that question is two issues. The employer mandate by itself will force many employers to reduce payrolls. That means they will either move people from full-time to part-time status, or they will have to eliminate positions in order to comply with the mandate that they must provide insurance. That's the issue. Just the medical device tax alone. The industry says that they're going to lose 44,000 jobs, a 2.8% tax on medical devices. That's 44,000, over 40,000, just from one industry sector. But between the employer mandate and many of the punitive taxes, there are 21 new or higher taxes in the law, many of which are going to have very, very, very real impacts. And you're going to see all sorts of consolidations, I believe, in the whole health insurance field. You'll have far fewer health insurance companies, I can tell you that, and you're going to have a few big ones left, and they're going to look like regulated public utilities. And I know you want to go in the utility realm, but that will generally force up costs, not bring them down. And so what we're seeing with this law is costs are rising by over 2,000.
Okay, we're going to cut that. Congressman Dent, it's your turn for your first question to Mr. Daugherty.
Sure. Rick, do you agree with President Obama and his administration? Do you think they are wrong to prevent the construction of the Keystone Pipeline? Or do you agree with me that the project should be expedited and approved?
Well, the oil coming from the Keystone Pipeline is going to go right through our country and be shipped overseas. So the benefits to that would be the construction jobs that would be there. And I do support that, and I believe the president also did support it. What he was looking for, Charlie, though, was additional time to be able to make sure that the environmental impact would not be significant, because it's over an aquifer that's in the middle of the country, that's in the middle of our breadbasket, so it's not something that you can take lightly. It's something that you have to make sure you study adequately, and they were looking to continue to do that. Congress cut them short, and they weren't able to make sure that the aquifer was going to be protected. Once that's spoiled, the breadbasket that's in the middle of our country is gone. So it's a pretty serious issue, and I commend the administration for looking at it in detail before they made the decision. I think it was a wise move.
Congressman Dent, I'm going to let you ask a follow-up as I did Mr. Daugherty.
Well, the question was, would you have the State Department issue the permit now? not wait. The State Department's job is not to do environmental reviews. The aquifer you're referring to is in Nebraska. The pipeline has been rerouted. There are no issues on the environmental side at this point. This is just simply the administration pandering to the extremists on the environmental side and making us less energy independent. We're going to be taking in more Venezuelan oil instead of Canadian oil because of this inaction. I just wish if you would answer, would you support the approval of the pipeline permit now?
Well, if, as you say, there are no environmental issues, then of course I would support it. But I think that's the question that remains to be answered.
So that's undecided then.
Okay, Mr. Daugherty, your turn for a question.
Okay. Can you name some of the corporate deductions that you would eliminate, including how much they would bring into the Treasury now as part of the process to lower corporate tax rates?
Well, sure. Why don't we start with ethanol? Why don't we limit ethanol subsidies? That's one easy place to go. And there are plenty of subsidies elsewhere. The truth is our corporate tax rate is at 35%. It's the highest in the developed world. Even President Obama agrees that we need to limit deductions on the business side and bring the rate down something in the 20s. That's progress. Where I disagree with this administration, I think with you too, they want to lower rates for the largest corporations in America, they want to raise tax rates on small businesses from 35% to over 40%. I think that's unfair. So there are plenty of areas. There are $100 billion worth of tax expenditures each year in the tax code, many of which are going to be out on the table, and we're going to end up limiting many of them, eliminating others. In exchange for that, we're going to get a lower rate, and we'll move this country back to a territorial tax system like the rest of the developed world does. I think that's something else we should do as part of the corporate tax reform.
Congressman Dent, your next question.
Sure. Rick, getting people back to work is America's highest priority. You support the health care law, which the CBO, the nonpartisan CBO, is projecting will lead to the elimination of over 800,000 jobs, which we discussed. You propose tariffs that will lead to trade wars and lost American jobs. Here in Pennsylvania, you want to stop the development of natural gas in the Marcellus Shale. I think you said that at the Kutztown Democratic Club. Exactly where in your economic plans do you actually stop killing jobs and start creating them?
Well, first of all, Charlie, we're in the middle of a trade war now, and we're losing. I want us to win. And that's why I do support the Affordable Health Care Act. First of all, it will put us at a level playing field with other industrialized countries who already provide health care to their workers. And second of all, stopping unfair trade policies is going to bring jobs back. If you look at since China became part of the WTO, our trade deficit has been huge. And our manufacturing job loss has been at 34%. So the trade war's on, Charlie. It's just that we're losing it, and I want to change it and have us winners, because we do have the best workforce in the world. We do have the best infrastructure in the world. It's just that Congress sold us out, beginning with NAFTA, and we need to turn that around.
Mr. Daugherty, your next question.
H.R. 3596 is the Call Center Worker and Consumer Protection Act. Given the fact that T-Mobile moved jobs overseas, and it wasn't because of the Obama administration, because there's lots of jobs that the Philippines are now anticipating moving from here to there, why have you not co-sponsored that legislation?
Well, actually, let's set the record straight. T-Mobile most assuredly moved those jobs offshore from Lehigh County, 604 jobs, because they were not allowed to merge with AT&T. I sent a letter to the FCC making them aware that I had public commitments from AT&T to make sure that they would not only maintain the call center jobs at the seven that were closed, including the one in Allentown, but they would repatriate 5,000 jobs to the United States. It was the FCC that said no. They have a 19th century mentality with respect to antitrust. That's what's wrong with the regulatory process. The Justice Department came in as well. That has been the problem. That's why we lost those jobs. That bill would not have saved those jobs. It was direct actions, a regulatory assault that was misguided that cost those jobs. That is a fact, and I'd be happy to, again, share with you and anyone else who's interested the documentation as to why we lost those jobs. That bill wouldn't have changed it. These are actions of the federal government that stopped it.
Congressman Dent, your next question.
Sure. Rick, you're a staunch supporter of the health care law or Obamacare. Supporters of the law promised that the health care premiums would go down on average by $2,500 for a typical family policy. Unfortunately, again, the nonpartisan CPO notes The health care costs for the typical family have gone up by $1,200 since the law was enacted and are projected to go even higher. Obamacare is paid for in part by 21 newer higher taxes it contains that are placed on middle-income individuals, health care providers, and businesses of all kinds. Do you believe that these new taxes and tax increases will result in higher health care costs for Americans?
Well, not at all, because the senior center where I work has now gotten two rebate checks of over $3,000 each on health care reform. My barber on Union Boulevard got a check in August for $1,200, and it's estimated that there's, $12.3 billion that's going to be returned to consumers because of the Affordable Health Care Act. So, in fact, consumers now are already seeing reductions and rebates in their health premiums, and I think it's a very good thing.
Mr. Daugherty, your next question.
International Battery Company, you were able to secure a $2.1 million federal earmark to fund the development of a particular system. The company closed up in March, and I'm wondering if you're aware of what happened to that $2.1 million.
The company you're referring to is International Battery. They have recently been acquired by a company called Brentronics. Brentronics Battery International, I believe, is the name of the company. They have rehired some of the workers. They have fulfilled, as my understanding, that the International Battery had fulfilled most of the terms of the contract as it relates to building lithium-ion batteries and research for heavy combat systems for the Army. It was a contract. Most of that contract, I believe, has been fulfilled. If there's any part of that contract that is unfulfilled, I am told by Brentronics that they intend to, if possible, fulfill any balance of that contract. So the work has largely been completed, and the company has been reopened.
Congressman Dent, your next question.
Yeah, Rick, my question to you is about the position you took during the primary. Specifically, at the primary debate, you said that you were opposed to the continuation of foreign terrorists being kept and tried at the Guantanamo Bay military prison. In fact, you said you were disappointed that President Obama did not veto a defense authorization bill that kept Guantanamo Bay open. Do you support the closing of the Guantanamo Bay military prison, and do you favor bringing foreign terrorists to the United States mainland for imprisonment and trial?
I do. I believe that we should close Guantanamo Bay, and they should be imprisoned here and put on trial in this country.
Okay, this is the last set for each of you. Mr. Daugherty, this is your last question.
I am very supportive of the Affordable Health Care Act, but I realize there are many things that need to change, and I've spoken about them before. You're supportive of the Ryan voucher plan for Medicare. Is there anything in that plan that you would like to change?
Well, the House passed budget does not include vouchers. It includes a program called premium support. Where we differ, Rick, is you like to say that, you know, you don't want to make any changes to anything. Well, the truth is bankruptcy is a choice, and bankruptcy means immediate benefit reductions for current beneficiaries. That will be the reality of this situation for people who are currently on those programs. What I support is protecting people on Medicare, like my 83-year-old widowed mother and everybody else, them and everybody who's nearly on, to make sure that they get what they were promised. At the same time, I think that the idea of premium support that came out of Alice Rivlin and the Clinton administration is something that ought to be on the table. Let seniors keep traditional Medicare or opt into something different. We already do premium support. It's called Medicare Part D. We do premium support. It's called the Federal Employee Benefit System for federal civilian employees and members of Congress. And this is not an alien concept. Federally approved programs, it's been done. In fact, premium support worked so well for Medicare Part D, the costs have come in 40% below projections.
Final question, Congressman Dent.
On the issue of, defense spending, Rick, you point that we, the United States, need to withdraw from virtually everywhere in the world. You also propose to put in place huge tariffs, which will shrink American access to the world's developing markets. Do you view America as a superpower? And if you do, how do you square that with your bent towards military and economic isolationism? How do you think that grows an economy and makes us a stronger nation?
Well, we are a superpower. We're the only superpower remaining in the world. And our allies, especially those in Europe and Japan and South Korea, their economies are strong enough that they need to pay for their own defense. There's no reason for us to build a missile shield to protect Europe from Iranian missiles. The Europeans should pay for their own missile shield. I'm tired of us paying on our dime for their defense. Our defense spending has doubled in the last 10 years. The European Union defense spending has decreased, and it's projected to decrease another 20%. So as a superpower, we're in the lead, but we shouldn't be a patsy for other countries to take advantage of us. Because in addition to us then covering for them, with defense spending, they undercut us economically. And it's time for us to fight for us, for our workers, for our values, and for our tax dollars.
Okay, gentlemen, that round of questioning is now over, and we're going to move on. It is time to turn to a question submitted via Facebook. Each candidate gets 30 seconds to respond, and our question comes from Bernie O'Hare. Let's watch the monitors.
This is the beautiful Lehigh River towpath from which you can ride between Allentown and Easton, sometimes without seeing a car. My question is, what will you do if elected to Congress to promote more infrastructure like this, which would in turn reduce the demand for gasoline, get people out of their cars and riding more often, and hopefully reduce our energy dependence? Thank you.
Mr. Daugherty, you get to answer first.
I am very supportive of programs like that for a number of reasons. First of all, it enhances our community health, because when we get out and about and when we're walking and bike riding and enjoying the outdoors, we're healthier. And as I mentioned before, 75% of health care costs are for chronic conditions like diabetes and high blood pressure, both of which are successfully dealt with simply through exercise. So I'm very supportive of those efforts, and specifically for us to be able to lower health care costs.
Congressman Dent.
Well, first, it's good to see Bernie O'Hare riding his bicycle. He lost a lot of weight, and he looked pretty good out there. But I wanted to say this. Clearly, to the extent that we pass a highway reauthorization bill, we do allow for some of these funds to be used for alternative modes of transportation, you know, for bike paths and trails and other things of the sort. We've extended our programs. We've given great discretion to the states to use their limited dollars as they best see fit, and that may include trails, as Bernie pointed out, or bike paths, whatever the case may be. So there is some funding mechanisms in place right now, and again, discretion is going to be left largely up to the states how they want to allocate those resources.
Thank you so much, gentlemen. Well, I think we're at our final question. We'll get a time in just a moment, and it comes from our morning call reporter, Colby. It will be directed to both candidates, and each will have 30 seconds to respond. Mr. Dent will get to answer first, and then Mr. Daugherty.
Mr. Dent, as you well know, one of the biggest problems in Washington is partisan gridlock. It accounts for Congress's low approval ratings. Next year, if reelected, name one issue that you will work with the other side of the aisle on to get done.
Well, I'm going to work on the biggest issue of all with the other side of the aisle, and that is the long-term challenge we're facing. And that means we are going to have to deal with the long-term debt in a responsible manner. I think the Simpson-Bowles plan was a good model, was an outline. It's not perfect. It's a little soft on health care, weak on health care. That can be fixed. But I've already been working in a bipartisan manner with leaders in both parties and people on the outside as well to try to deal with a responsible entitlement spending reform and a tax reform that's going to get this country moving in the right direction. So that's the one issue that I pledge right now to do, and I've already been doing it and will continue to.
I'm going to look to work with Republicans in every way that I can, because I think Republicans also have very good ideas. But this is across the board. This is going to be in terms of health care reform, in terms of trade policies, in terms of military spending. I'm going to reach out and I'm going to make it a point to co-sponsor legislation that's brought up by Republicans and to do everything I can to coordinate with them, because I do believe that only by working together are we going to be able to solve these problems. And what's been happening with Congress lately shows that when you don't work together, the problems don't get solved.
Well, our last piece of business tonight is a one-minute closing statement from each candidate. Congressman Dent, we will start with you.
Well, again, I want to thank everybody involved with organizing this debate tonight. First, the issue in this election is jobs and the economy. People need to get back to work. And what I pledge to do is do essentially four things. One, we reform the tax code, make it more efficient, limit those 80,000 pages of the federal tax code, and let's broaden the base, lower rates. Two, maximize North American energy production so we can develop more industrial and manufacturing jobs. Three, open markets for American farmers, manufacturers, and other producers of products so that Americans, when we compete, we win. We have a great future in this country. I believe we can win when we compete. That's where I differ with Rick. Rick thinks that we've lost and we ought to, wave the white flag of surrender. I don't agree with that. Americans are competitive people. When we compete, we win. The other thing we need to do, fourth, is lower the national debt. Deal with it in a responsible way, as I just outlined. again, we can have a very bright future if we do it right. And tonight, I respectfully ask for your vote on November 6th. Thank you.
Mr. Daugherty, your closing comments, please.
If you feel that our trade agreements with China and Mexico have helped you to improve your life and have actually brought more jobs here, then I may not be the candidate for you, because I believe that those policies and programs have irreparably harmed our economy. Our workers are the most effective, the most loyal, the least likely to take vacation, the most hardworking of anybody in the world. And it was Congress that set up these trade policies going back 25, 30 years that have damaged the economy. It undercuts everything. When factories are not here, we pay higher real estate taxes. When workers don't have jobs, federal revenue goes down and needs increase. And payroll taxes for Social Security and Medicare are lessened. So if you're looking for a candidate who will fight for you to bring jobs back from other countries, then I respectfully ask for your support. Thank you.
Well, before we wrap things up tonight, we owe a big thank you to our candidates, our panelists, Chris and Colby, and to our audience here in the studio and our audience at home watching tonight. So this is where our audience here in the studio can give us a big round of applause for all of the candidates. We especially would like to thank PBS 39's partners, The Morning Call, Muhlenberg College, and the Greater Lehigh Valley Chamber of Commerce for making the debate possible. Don't forget to exercise your right to vote Tuesday, November 6th. Thank you so much for joining us, and good night.
This program is brought to you by the members of PBS 39 and by...
There once was a girl whose favorite color was red. Walk in confidence with Wolf Insurance, proudly insuring the Lehigh Valley for over 30 years.
Solberry School, a co-ed college.